Hey, what's up everybody? This is Mick. Welcome to our 13 part video tutorial series on custom collection view layouts. In this video tutorial series, you're going to learn everything that you need to know about developing custom layouts for collection views. You're going to start with the basics, such as creating and caching layout attributes, and then move through to some of the more advanced topics, such as interactive layouts and manipulating scroll behavior. Now, we recently ran a Twitter poll to find out what kind of layouts you guys are interested in seeing. And whilst we couldn't accommodate every request, if you did respond, then I do hope your suggestion made it into the series. Now, we're going to approach this series a little bit different to how we've done our others. And instead of each video focusing on a single topic or API, you're going to dive straight in, get your hands dirty, and across the 13 videos, you'll build 5 completely custom, fully functional layouts, 4 of which are influenced by real-world popular iOS apps. In this introduction, I'm going to show you some really cool demo videos just to whet your appetite and give you an idea of what we've got in store. And with that, let's dive straight in. Collection views borrow many of the familiar patterns from UI table view, such as having separate delegate and data source objects. But they also introduce a new third object, the layout. Layouts, which are instances of either UI collection view layout or its subclass UI collection view flow layout, are responsible for vending sets of layout attributes. Instances of UI collection view layout attributes manage the layout related attributes for a given item in a collection view. Layout objects create instances of this class and return them to the collection view as and when requested. The collection view then uses these layout attributes to position the cells and supplementary views within its bounds. The layout attributes are eventually passed on to the cells and supplementary views themselves, and we can hook into this process, which is especially useful if you want to pass custom information from the layout to the cells or supplementary views. And you'll be taking full advantage of this as we move through the series. There are 3 methods that any UI collection view layout subclass must override. The first, collection view content size, returns the height and width of the collection view's content. And now these values need to represent the entire content, not just the content that's currently visible on screen. The collection view then uses this information to configure its own content size used for scrolling purposes. The second method, prepare layout, is called whenever a layout operation is about to take place and gives your custom layout object an opportunity to prepare. And this is the ideal place to perform any computations needed to be able to complete that layout operation, such as calculating the frames of cells. The third and final method, layout attributes for elements in rect, returns all the layout attributes for any views within the collection view whose frames intersect with the given rectangle. And this rectangle usually represents the current visible area on screen. Let's start taking a tour through the different layouts you're going to be building throughout the rest of the series. In parts 1 to 3, you're going to be building a layout that's clearly influenced by the popular Pinterest iOS app, and which is based on UI collection view layout. You'll learn how to handle dynamically sized cells by leveraging a custom delegate protocol. You'll learn how to create and cache layout attributes, as well as implementing custom cell padding and insets. You'll also create your first set of custom layout attributes, which will enable you to pass information from the layout to the cells themselves. In parts 4 through 6, you'll build the ever popular stretchy header layout, but this one has a really cool effect inspired by the DIY Skills for Kids app. As the user scrolls, the header's background image scales down, but its foreground image scales up, which provides this fun sense of depth. This layout takes advantage of UI collection view flow layout and demonstrates how you can manipulate a collection view's supplementary views in the same way you can its cells. You'll once again take advantage of the ability to pass information from a layout to the relevant views using custom layout attributes, as well as how to leverage auto layout in this context to manage the image scaling. In part 7, you'll subclass UI collection view flow layout and implement behavior usually found in UI table view, sticky headers. This layout is completely self-contained, meaning it has no external dependencies, and can be used as a drop-in replacement anywhere you're already using UI collection view flow layout. This layout is also one of the more straightforward to implement and requires that you override just two methods. In parts 8 through 10, we're going to step things up a gear and you're going to build a layout influenced by the popular Ultravisual app. You'll start to bring together everything that you've learned up until this point in the series, as well as introducing a couple of the more advanced topics. You'll once again start with a subclass of UI collection view layout, as this offers the most flexibility, and you'll build your first truly interactive layout, which means that the state and visual appearance of the layout is directly affected by the way the user is currently interacting with it. You'll learn how to manipulate the target content offset of the collection view to achieve this nice snapping effect as the user scrolls. And you'll also learn how to create dependencies between the cell's visual interface elements and the current state of the layout. And finally, in parts 11 through 13, you're going to build the all singing, all dancing piece de resistance, a layout heavily influenced by the Timbre app for iOS. Now, admittedly, this layout is a little bit of a red herring, and you'd be forgiven for thinking it looks like it's going to be one of the most complex yet. But in terms of actual layout code, it has the least of any layout in the series. One of the goals of this series was to dispel the myth that creating complex custom layouts is difficult. And I think you'll really start to appreciate this as you work through videos 11, 12, and 13. You'll learn how to take full advantage of UI Collection View flow layout so that you have to write as little code as possible. You'll learn how to manipulate a cell's transform, as well as how to implement the parallax effect and how to tie that so it's directly affected by the user scrolling. You'll also leverage auto layout and view clipping to achieve the overall look and feel of the layout. And that's it for the introduction. And as always, we like to leave off with a challenge. So your challenge this time is to enjoy the video series. Either pick a specific layout that piques your interest, or work through a series from beginning to end. Hopefully you'll learn something new and have a great time in doing so. I hope you've enjoyed this introduction. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.